The Passion of Christ. Jesus presented himself to me as a simple being. You would not imagine it. His simplicity is so great. He told me that his heart was attached to the humble, Matthew 11:29, and not to higher things. He spoke of his birth in a stable in the midst of beasts, straw, stinky manure, and while he was talking about it I even felt the foul odor of this stable. He added that the fact that his coming into the world was discreet did not prevent that the fact that salvation by his death and his resurrection be eternal. He also told me that Satan had been deceived by his own evil thought, because he had been in the impossibility of imagining that the coming of the Son of God would take place under such conditions. Satan personality cannot conceive things simple and humble. Jesus assured me that the devil was waiting for a king like David, not a carpenter's son of humble condition. It is written he has risen up before him as a feeble plant, like an offspring out of a parched earth, had neither beauty nor brilliance to attract our attention, and his appearance had nothing to please us. Isaiah 53:2. Jesus then spoke to me about his sacrifice. He describes how he was nailed, how these nails tore his flesh, how this rough cross had wounded him all over his back, how much he suffered for the salvation of men. He truly burns with love for human being. The Spirit showed me a city of Israel. It was daylight, the sun was shining. There was a particular event which had attracted the population into the streets. I saw Jesus carrying a heavy cross. He was surrounded by a large crowd and was escorted by four soldiers. The crowd shouted, vociferated and was taunting the Son of God. He received their spittle and insults without lifting his eyes from the ground. He was advancing in silence. From his hair and beard spilled saliva and sweat. His face was marked by the pain and suffering. Some of the crowd looked silently with tears in their eyes. A fifth soldier wore a whip and violently beat Jesus' back while laughing. His skin was torn and red with blood. Sweating, dust and spitting mingled with this blood. His shoulder was bruised, so heavy and rough was this cross. Tears ran down his face, they were mingled with the blood coming down from his hair. I see this blood going down into his eyes and blinding him. His eyes were burning. He wore a crown of dry thorns. I saw them enter deeply and come out of his flesh in each one of his movements. Flies flew around him and landed on his wounds. It was unbearably hot. This show was unbearable. Unacceptable. Jesus was surrounded by people who pressed him. I also saw dogs mingled with the crowd. The soldiers had trouble retaining the crowd in order to protect Jesus from them as they could. I had the impression that without this protection, my Savior would have been lynched by these crowds that seems influenced by demons. Then they arrived on a hill. The cross was fixed to the ground. I saw the soldiers tying the Lord's hands to the cross with ropes and then nailing them. The nails were steel and very wide. Blood came out of his hands. The hammer blows of the soldier were frank and brutal. The face of Jesus reflected immense suffering but also immense sadness. My heart was torn to see him suffer so. He was fixed on that rough cross. The scene was heartbreaking. Jesus was very weak but struggled to keep a straight position. He suffered tremendously for us. The people were around the cross. There was a great uproar. They spat. They laughed and pointed at him. Some had wine bottles in their hands and they were offering Jesus in mockery. I could hear swearing, blasphemies in all this hubbub. His nudity was updated. I looked at his face and could see that he was beginning to weaken and lose consciousness. I turned my eyes towards the sky. The clouds had covered the sun, as before a storm. The people had not even paid attention to this, for they were so busy insulting, tormenting Lord. I even saw men sending coins to the soldiers so that they could tear his flesh and make him suffer. People's faces were not faces of men because they seemed possessed by demons. I could read wickedness on their features. I looked at Jesus. His feet could not support itself, and he could no longer support his body. Then his body slumped down. He had more and more trouble breathing. He was trying to inhale more air from his mouth by opening it even more. He suffered. He sought to retain life in his body. He said, "Ah, I give myself for this people. My Father. My Father. My Father. I am surrounded by the power of darkness. There is only darkness. There is only darkness on earth. Spirit of God. There is nothing but darkness. This people for whom I give myself, for whom I give myself. It was more and more difficult to fight. Life gradually disappeared from his body, and his spirit was going out of this body little by little and gradually. He seemed lifeless. I saw a soldier taking his spear deep into his ribs. I came to conclude that all these people were under the direction of the spirit of the enemy. Before Jesus, I saw the temple of Jerusalem. The angel of the Lord stood there, between the holy place and the most holy place. He was standing there full of strength and power. This is the only angel I saw. In his hand he held a scintillating and flashing sword. Then the sun he got darkened. People did not notice it. They did not even pay attention to it because they were so overwhelmed by rage in their hearts and demons leading them to insult and spit upon the Son of God. Then I saw Satan entering the holy temple of God. He wanted to oppose this angel who represented the presence of God in this place, and whose mission was to tear the thick veil separating the holy place from the place very holy. Satan's face was filled with a sense of victory. He was overjoyed and jubilant. The devil tried to assault the powerful angel of God standing around the veil. There was a dreadful and formidable physical battle between the angel of the Lord and Satan. The fight was terrible, but Satan never had the upper hand in this fight. Then the Lord brought down his spirit into the temple of God. Satan was thrown out of the temple. I saw the spirit of Jesus going away from his body. There was an earthquake at that moment. Then all his body stiffened and then fell lifeless, hanging by the arms. Jesus died. This sight was awful. A lifeless body, naked, stained, hanged to a wood like a trophy. It was gruesome. My heart was seized with great anguish. My ears hurt. The shouts of the crowd almost deadened my eardrums. I felt the pain of Jesus in my body. It was unbearable. Jesus truly suffered. He died in inhuman conditions. Then I heard the roar of thunder. The crowd fell silent. A great silence then took place. I saw the disciples. They cried by tearing their clothes and rolling on the floor. Mary, the mother of Jesus, was there, weeping, suffering in his bowels at the foot of the cross. She was sorry. She seemed completely lost. Her mother's heart was suffering. I saw the spirit of Jesus hovering above the cross. I looked at those souls who wept, and I recognized John, Lazarus among them. The show was heartrending. The soldiers did not know what to do. They seemed seized. The spear remained hanging between the coasts of the Lord. It hung in the air. The soldiers did not know what to do. The people no longer knew what to say. A heavy silence weighed on Jerusalem. The veil of the temple was torn by the hand of the angel in a dry noise. The Spirit of God filled this temple to such an extent that men had to come out of it. But darkness covered Jerusalem. At that moment I saw the Spirit of Jesus appearing before the throne of God. He was released. He carried in his hands a kind of box, which he placed at the foot of the throne. The Spirit tells me that this box represented the sin of the world. A voice began to shout, "O rejoice, thou shalt be glad, for he has taken thy sin, has taken your sin and laid it at the foot of his Father." The angels rejoiced. The kingdom of God was filled with songs and laughter. Joy reigned. The music went up before the throne of Jehovah. I saw the sea of glass, angels dancing there round the crystal river. The prophets rejoiced because the prophecy had been fulfilled. He had accomplished his mission. The Spirit of God showed me the cross. Two soldiers were releasing the body of Jesus. The nails had been so sunk. They had difficulty removing them. When they managed to remove them, with shreds of fresh flesh, I could see large drops of sweat on these soldiers' foreheads. Jesus was torn, torn up. I wondered how men could have done such an act of savagery. That was the proper term, savagery. His body was emptied of his blood, completely pale. He wore purple bruises. His body was sticky with sweat, blood, and dry saliva. The spit dripped from his beard and flowed over his body. His chest was stained with vomit. It was dreadful. Flies circled around his body and landed on him. Dogs were even looking in order to lick the blood that had been shed. This body was lifeless. Without life. The lance of the soldier had remained hanging in his ribs. They tried to take it away. It was so soaked that the soldier could not hold the handle. It slipped from hands. The scene was horrible. Horrible. I had never seen a body so torn. He gave his body for us. The body was carried to the servants of God. Mary the mother did not even dare look at this body. She seemed lost and repeated these words, "They tore my son's body, the child I carried and I raised." Why did they do that? The pain was upon his disciples. They cried not knowing what to do. They sought consolation that did not seem to come. Never had Jerusalem experienced such a horrible day. "I saw Peter, he went and came back in tears, he did not understand, forgive me" are his words, "forgive me." Her tears flowed over the body of her Savior. The disciples took water to clean the body, they wiped a cloth on his body, his hair, his beard, his eyes. The blood was so dry, they had to rub and rub it so that it comes out. His lifeless body was moving like a mannequin. His wounds were still open and they were still shedding blood with a kind of liquid transparent. The moment was poignant. The disciples did not even dare look at the remains of their Lord. They closed their eyes while cleaning. They wondered where they would still hear words of comfort, if Jerusalem knew yet such a prophet such as Lord. The body was perfumed from head to foot. The perfume embalmed the house. The disciples wrapped the corpse of the Son of God with a white linen. They carried it and transported into a sepulchre. The day was falling. The body was placed in the middle of this sepulchre. Its entrance was blocked with a stone. The disciples went away thoughtfully. "The Spirit then showed me what was going on in the sepulchre. It was dark, I could not see anything. Suddenly it was filled with a bright light. The light of God lit up the inside of the sepulchre. This scene was wonderful and glorious. Angels of God stood beside the corpse of the Lord. They were calm and talking among themselves. They seemed to be waiting for something. No more noise was heard, not even the sound of a bird. Then the Spirit of God descended, little by little. He descended on the body of the Lord. Like a mantle, it came down little by little. We were on the third day. The Spirit of God filled the body of the Son of God. The Spirit returned into this body. It was something glorious. The glorified body was covered with the powerful light of the Holy Spirit. I witnessed the resurrection of Jesus. Glorious. The sepulchre trembled on every side. The glory of the Lord had returned to this sepulchre. There were two soldiers on duty before the enormous rock that closed the sepulchre. They did not know more than they did. They did not understand what was going on. The earth trembled. Their faces were filled with fear. The angel of God who had torn the veil of the temple, directed his sword against the stone of the sepulchre. It shook and was shattered. Jesus went out of the sepulchre, advancing with a calm step. He was dressed in a scarlet white brighter than white. I saw his wounds. They were blackened and healed. His face was filled with grace and peace. He reflected no rancor or spirit of vengeance, merely a deep love. It was glorious. Completely clothed with the Holy Spirit, he was resplendent. Resurrected. He is risen. Clothed with the Spirit of God. I saw my Lord, my love, risen and glorified. Praise for eternity. Infinite grace of God to all men. Jesus Christ died for our sins and risen for eternal glory. Believe in him, you will have eternal life. He said, "I am the resurrection and the life. He who believes in me that he is dead will live, and whoever lives and believes in me will not die forever." Later the Lord Jesus said to me, "There is a mystery you ought to know. In the day when my spirit was taken from this body, the day I expired on this wood, my spirit visited the shadows of the world. I descended into the kingdom of the lower world. I broke the chains. I presented myself before the devil. He could not even contain my presence. After my death my spirit broke the chains of the captives held by the devil, who could not sustain my presence so much that he hid his face before me." Jesus assured me of the love of God for all men, of the sufficiency of his sacrifice for salvation of anyone who believes. The way of salvation is simple, limpid and perfect. Believe and you will be saved. The cross is an authority. The blood is an authority. The blood purifies. The anointing is on you. The devil had never thought that it was by such way, by such foulishness for the world, that I would give my salvation. The devil thought that I would have come as a king over a people, but he had forgotten that the Lord gives consideration to the humble. The Lord is of a simplicity that would surpass you if you knew it. Born in a stable, in the smell of rotting beasts, in the smell of animal droppings, I was lying on the grass that was soiled. Mary knew these things. Joseph knew these things. The Lord is simple. Kings have come to worship me. They have worshipped with simplicity. Of these foolish things the Lord would make stones. You are a foolish things for the world, and I will make a stone of this foolishness.